Our next stop this week are the atomists, Leucippus and Democritus. They're pretty close in dates, but Leucippus is credited as being the first proponent of the atomic hypothesis. And they're both usually classified as the early atomists in contrast with later ones such as Epicurus and then many Romans. Both were from Abdera in Thrace, also the birthplace of the sophist Protagoras, and thus must be situated, of course, in Ionian natural philosophy. Democritus acquired the nickname Laugher, apparently because he used to laugh at anyone who would not recognize the truth behind conventional reality. This will result in the history of Western art in many fine paintings. Of the two pre-Socratics who Western painters seem to most remember, Heraclitus the weeping philosopher and Democritus the laughing one. Democritus is said to have visited Athens and may have met Socrates there, but was disappointed that nobody had heard of him. I came to Athens and nobody knew me. I don't think this is a statement of personal egotism or arrogance, so much as a simple pointing out of the facts. The Athenian political context was not always well informed about philosophical developments occurring in the Ionian city-states. They were insular and inward-looking. It was the Athenians who are arrogant here. On Leucippus's Atomism, Karatani writes that he was the first to conceive of an infinite number of identical elements themselves not capable of further division, called atoms. And against Parmenides and Pythagoras, he introduced the idea of the void as the empty space in which the atoms move. So nothing, non-being, kenon, or the void for atomism, in fact exists. Like in previous weeks, we're hearing some inconsistent things between Stamatelos and Karatani. The atomist theory of elements posits that there are only two things, atoms and the void. But already we have misstepped and must parse our words carefully. What does it really mean to talk about the being or reality of the void? This is a semantic question and one of perspective. Modern scientists will often talk about the atomic universe as being mostly empty space. But does it really make sense to assign the predicate of being or the is reality, there is, to the void? Stamatelos here rests his interpretation on fragment A6 of Democritus, and if you look at it, it's simply the testimony of Aristotle. In Aristotle's reading of the atomists, according to them, what is no more than what is not, and what is empty is as real as any body. Aristotle is a venerable authority, to be sure, and one of our only major sources for the pre-Socratics. But in the absence of other evidence, should we really conclude that Aristotle got Leucippus and Democritus right here? Is it not just as elegant to propose for the atomists as Karatani does their lineage within Ionian natural philosophy, including Parmenides? Only the atoms are, the plenum, plenary being, what is, and the void is not. When we speak of the void as being, or as modern science does, as there being more void than there is atoms, we can do so only with a very loose concept of being. Why not rather see the void kenon is not, non-being the nothing? Only atoms, that is, the material principles, exist. Perhaps what Aristotle was on about is a tendency in the early atomists and their disciples to speak of the void as if it were being, or reality in some sense, but this being an inconsistency into which their philosophy was led by our ordinary, everyday use of language. In the strict sense, only atoms exist and the void does not exist. Of course, this will not stop us from continually sliding into the habit of attributing some sort of reality or being to the void. Again, I find Karatani's position linking early atomism to Ionian natural philosophy and not overestimating a false dichotomy with Parmenides to be more compelling. Parmenides was arguing against the Pythagorean notion that the world is generated from the void. Leucippus more concurs with Parmenides, but conceives the void as the empty space which atoms, as a fullness, move, the atoms themselves being indivisible or atomon, and through their mutual colliding and entanglements, all things come to be. In this way, Leucippus was able to preserve Parmenides' thinking while accounting for a world of multiplicity, and his own pupil, Democritus, pushed this line of thinking forward. Leucippus is said to have written only one book on mind. Wow, finally a book that's not called On Nature. But Democritus was a prolific author, writing, according to some accounts, hundreds of texts. A real athlete, pentathlos, in philosophical writing. Going to combat, or the Greek dialectical agon, as a game in all sorts of fields. And always coming out the victor in his arguments. His most significant books were The Great World System, On the Nature of the World, and The Lesser World System. Alas, none of Democritus's complete writings have survived, but only a few stray fragments, mostly on ethics. The early atomists may have been in contact with Hindu and Oriental philosophy. Indeed, slightly before their time, in the 6th century BCE, the Hindu philosopher Kanada developed a theory of atoms. Kanada's theory, however, has a teleological slant not observed in the extant fragments of Democritus. As a whole, Greek atomism and teleology go in opposite directions, the atomist tending to propose contingent adaptive evolution. The atomist proposed a number of beautiful words to describe the atomic universe, which are still very much enchanting today, such as intertwining, scattering, and the plurality of worlds. In regards to the two great cosmic principles, or being and non-being, atoms and the void, both are infinite. Infinity is thus removed as being a real predicate of being. Different bodies are composed of the same atoms, as tragedies and comedies are composed of the same letters, and atoms differ in shape, position, and order, but not in quality. Most fascinating from the point of view of contemporary atomic physics, the early atomists proposed that the motion of atoms causes collision that results either in atomic intertwining or atomic scattering. This is pretty much all you need to create the periodic table of elements, but alas, only if you had very powerful electron microscopes or atom smashers, or in the old days of cosmic ray physics, went up with plates in a hot air balloon to see how the atoms scatter when they strike the surface of the atmosphere. Of course, none of this was available to the pre-Socratic philosophers, and so the theory of atomic intertwining and scattering wasn't much more developed than this. For the atomists, all generation, destruction, and perceptual motion are the result of perpetual motion of atoms in the infinite void. And like Anaxagoras, the atomists envisioned a universe containing a plurality of worlds, an open universe with numerous solar systems and galaxies. This atomic universe is described in Diogenes Laertius. Atoms move randomly in the void. Some atoms with compatible movements come together and start a vortex. As a result of the collision of similar atom groups through the vortex, atoms are caught up in various rotations and then begin to separate off. Atoms rotate in equilibrium, abiding together and getting intertwined, and thus they make up the initial sphere. Wow, this vortex talk, especially in atomism, seems to be a definite forerunner of the field of quantum physics. What these macro combinations of atoms produce are the planetary bodies or spheres surrounded by a cosmic membrane that encloses them. The details of planetary and solar formation are still pretty unclear, but the atomists seem to be definite precursors of the nebular hypothesis. In Stamatelos, for Leucippus and Democritus, the atoms are the new being, while the void proves that not being is as real as being. Karatani's reading here makes the atomists less antithetical to Parmenides. What are we really saying about being when we speak of the full and the empty? What is and what is not? Is the empty or kenon void truly just as real as any body? What is the sense of the word reality here? A whole is full, a plenum, and we might say that only the atoms really exist to make up this whole. The atomists are also credited with being the first consistent determinists, having worked out a fully consistent theory of atomic determinism. Leucippus asserts in the only extant fragment from his work on mind that we should consider that nothing occurs at random, but everything for a reason and by necessity, this being one of the earliest statements of the principle of sufficient reason. Atomic necessity, in Greek anarche, also understood as a goddess in Pythagoras and Plato, is related to the pre-cosmic initial motion of atoms in the void and describes the non-planned sequence of physical events contra divine intervention. Every event in the world becomes the result of the chain of atomic collisions, actions, and reactions. So atomism is the first time that we see contingency and chance as the very arche rather than something divine. As to what the atomists believe about the divine, death, or the human soul, interpretations can vary. One claim that does not vary is that at death, the atoms disperse and may regroup into other compounds. There are two basic views here. One is that the human soul is nothing but the totality of its atomic signatures, so when the human being dies, the soul gives up the ghost as well. But the other is that there are two types of atoms, physical and spiritual, and that the soul is of the latter type. and may survive the death of the body in some sense. Later, atomism will develop and debate these conflicting hypotheses. All we can say for certain regarding the soul in early atomism is that Democritus claimed that an individual person is a microcosm or miniature cosmos, and that the soul is the source of bodily motion and intelligence. So clearly he had some doctrine of the soul, but whether it is itself an individual atom or merely a collection of atoms will be left to later debates. On perception, appearance, and reality, the atomists also had some very interesting hypotheses. Perception results from the outflowing of atoms of the perceived object, which connect with the relevant sense organs, and the apparent qualities of this object exist only by convention. This is a precursor of Locke's distinction between primary qualities in the object itself and secondary qualities only in the mind which perceives them. And it seems to be basically correct. The outflowing of atoms of the perceived objects we now know are photons, which the eye and brain translate into merely apparent or secondary qualities. In fact, we can even see the atomists here as precursors of Bishop Berkeley, who argued against Locke that we only perceive secondary qualities, never primary ones. For Democritus, by convention, sweet and bitter, and by convention, hot and cold, and by convention, color, but in reality, atoms and the void. In reality, we know nothing for certain, but there is change according to the conditions of the body and what enters into it and comes up against it. Democritus also made a further distinction between appearance and reality. In reality, only atoms and the void exist, and the perceptible world is just a compound of atoms and the void. I think we can all see that the early atomists are the closest thing we get to an anti-theology, early Greek philosophy. They may be the closest thing to atheists, but this is also disputed. We can say that the atomists were more strictly materialist in their explanation than other pre-Socratics. However, Democritus also wrote extensively on the psyche and how psychical structures correspond to physical ones. In fact, most of his 160 extant fragments are concerned with ethics, his most comprehensive ethical work being titled On Serenity or Ataraxia, a theme that will become very important in Hellenistic thought. What exactly the psyche or soul is in atomism, we're not quite sure. But understanding and nurturing it aright is clearly central for Democritean ethics. And this ethics is deeply moral and posits a moral universe oriented by natural law. So even if the atomists were atheistic and anti-theology, emphasizing chance as the origin of all things, this would not lead for them into an amoral or anti-moral universe, such as in Nietzsche's Beyond Good and Evil. In some fragments and testimonia regarding the soul in Democritean atomism, the soul is material, composed of exceedingly fine spherical atoms, whose nature is never to be still, but like fire moves other bodies from within. The difference between these exceedingly fine atoms and ordinary ones is that they are able to move other bodies from within. All sensation is a differential sensorium produced by the interaction of atoms of different types. And another important upshot for the atomists is that since atoms in the void mediate all our sensory activity or human sensorium, we have no immediate access to things. We are cut off from the real by the nature of sensation. Our concepts of reality are conventional. Maybe the soul still sees the real. In opening up a more atheological and chance-oriented image of thought, the early atomists are often said to be important precursors of ancient skepticism and cynicism. On the health of the soul, Democritus writes that disease occurs in a household or in a life, just as it does in a body. Medicine cures the diseases of the body. Wisdom, on the other hand, relieves the soul of its suffering. The needy animal knows how much it needs, but the needy man does not. What this implies is that without philosophy and wisdom, humanity exists in a spiritual poverty, even more intense than the poverty of need and want in the animal body. It is hard to fight with desire, but to overcome it is the mark of rationality, and moderation in orso fortune increases enjoyment and makes pleasures even greater, a view we see across the pre-Socratics richly developed in Plato and Aristotle. The good things of life are produced by learning with hard work. The bad are reaped of their own accord without hard work. The brave man is he who overcomes not only his enemies, but also his pleasures. And there are some men who are masters of cities, but slaves to women. Showing here that misogyny and manliness are clearly enduring traits of the Greek philosophical legacy. In cattle, excellence is displayed in the strength of the body, but in men it lies in the strength of character. And Democritus is famously said to have proclaimed that I would rather discover a single cause than become the king of Persia. From his ethical writings, especially on the health of the soul, we can clearly see that Democritus is very Greek, although perhaps something in contrast to Plato or Pythagoras of a Greek pragmatist. The goal of living well and philosophically is to attain serenity, or ataraxia, defined as enjoyment and the avoidance of extremes. Serenity comes to people from moderation in pleasure and harmony in life. Appropriate choices establish habit over time that lessen the force of external impacts on the soul. In fragment B189, it is best for a man to live his life as serenely as possible and with the least distress. So Democritus is sort of the original Raffi, teaching, don't worry, be happy. Appropriate habits minimize the internal disturbances of the soul and strengthen the coherence of its structure. And nature and teaching are similar, for teaching reforms the individual and in reforming establishes his nature. A few other quotable Democritus quotes. Continuous hard work becomes easier as you get used to it. Note this well as our semester proceeds. Having a new thought each day, the best way of life for man. Hopefully the silver lining of all your hard work this semester. The soul is the home of the daimon. Soul and mind are the same. This fragment definitely suggesting that Democritus, like the other pre-Socratics, may be more religious in his thinking than most commentators see at first glance. Man is a microcosm. Learning achieves fine things through effort, but what is shameful comes automatically without effort. The serene man doing what is just and lawful, waking and sleeping, is glad and strong and carefree. Become accustomed to finding joy in yourself. The wise man can walk the whole earth, for the entire cosmos is the homeland of the good soul. This fragment will be particularly important for Karatani's identifying of the atomists and Democritus as cosmopolitan proponents of isonomy or isonomia. As stated explicitly in the next quote, poverty in a democracy is clearly preferable to so-called prosperity under tyranny. Just so is freedom preferable to slavery. On Democritus, Karatani writes, it is not difficult to discern here an ethicality that we do not find in the Athenian philosophers. In Athens, people are subordinate to the polis, and all ethics flows from that point. However, for Democritus, a human being is, in essence, independent of the polis, and each person is a world unto themselves, a microcosm. Hence, for Democritus, true ethics cannot come from within the polis, rather only from the cosmopolis. In the latter part of his reading of Democritus, Karatani helpfully points to Karl Marx's doctoral dissertation, The Difference Between the Democritean and Epicurean Philosophies of Nature. According to Marx, Democritus was a sensationalist and mechanistic determinist, and to that degree a skeptic. This made Democritus opposed to the Athenian tendency in Plato and especially Aristotle towards a teleological doctrine of nature. According to Marx, it was in this space between Democritus and Aristotle that Epicurus developed his thinking, firmly on the side of atomic materialism, but also asserting a random atomic swerve. It is this swerve in atomic motion which, while mechanistic, brings about a variation that appears teleological in effect. In this way, the young Marx discovered in Epicurus an attempt to criticize both teleology and mechanistic determinism based on the idea of the atomic swerve. Marx's dialectical materialism can itself be seen as a revival of Ionian natural philosophy. We'll be returning more to Epicurean atomism in a later unit. For now, it suffices to point out that in Democritean atomism, atoms move through space with absolute linearity. Whereas the poet Lucretius in On the Nature of Things attributes to Epicurus the view that atoms do not always fall in a straight line. They rather swerve, and this has been called the clinamen. Just enough of a swerve, Lucretius sings, for us to call it a change of course. This debate as to the nature of atomic motion from Democritus to Epicurus and Lucretius mirrors precisely the way modern physicists talk about quantum indeterminacy versus a strictly classical or Newtonian cosmos. According to quantum mechanics, there really is an indeterminacy as to the location of atoms in the quantum world. They are both waves and particles, and obey probabilistic laws, and are thus radically unpredictable, even to the point of the quantum principle of action at a distance. Is this really how the universe is in and of itself, or how it appears to us through our experiments? Does the quantum mechanical universe really defy classical mechanics from Newton to Einstein in some fundamental way? We don't know, but it's interesting that these debates were already being had 500 years ago. Democritus's fully deterministic atomic universe giving way in popularity to Epicurus's model of the atoms as swerving, for it is from this clinamen or swerve in the greatest concatenation that we can explain the formation of things on contingent bases, as well as our own acts of free will as operations of the clinamen or swerve of the atom, writ large in the mesocosmic space of the human body and soul. As is usual in our study of ancient Greek philosophy, the source of all the difficulty often goes back to how we interpret Aristotle. In Karatani's masterful reading of the concept of isonomia, both natural and social-political, as a core feature and concern across pre-Socratic thought, and in his emphasis on the affinities rather than the differences of all the pre-Socratics with respect to Ionian materialism, he provides a synthetic reading of the overall unity of Ionian natural thought versus key differences with the classical Athenian thought which followed, that of Socrates, Plato, and Aristotle. So I'd like to conclude this lecture this week, and in fact our entire unit on the pre-Socratics, by returning briefly to Karatani's chapter on the principles of Ionian natural philosophy, which we covered a few weeks ago but didn't quite get to the end of. In the latter parts of that chapter, Karatani defines the key difference between pre-Socratic and classical thought as residing in the fact that the Ionians unanimously refused the idea of a final cause. Nature's becoming of itself differs from making precisely because it has no cause or aim. In Aristotle's thought, there is always a distinction between natural beings and beings made by human making, techne or poesis. In Greek, phusionta, the realm of beings in nature, which have their principles of birth, growth, generation, and destruction in themselves, and on the other, technionta, intentional objects made with a view to a final cause, or purpose for their use. In fact, Aristotle takes the idea of technionta, or the functionality of things in the world, and to some degree projects it back into phusionta, the realm of natural beings. Phusis itself, or nature, is a teleological system where everything serves a purpose or function. The pre-Socratics, however, did not need to explain techne as a separate sphere from phusis. Inventiveness or creativity is part of nature's becoming, not only in the human sphere. So the distinction of creativity and becoming never really took hold among the pre-Socratics, such that God would then be understood as a great maker or demiurge who works in the world much as human artisans work with their artifacts. According to Karatani, precisely this lack of a distinction between nature and creativity was part and parcel of the many technological innovations in the period of Ionian ascendancy, while there were virtually no major technological inventions in the age of Athens. Karatani goes on, Aristotle's formal and final causes are modeled on the realization of biological forms latent in the embryo or seed. While this was useful in explaining the persistence over time of the same species, it provided no account of how a new species could come into being. More to the point, the problem never seems to have occurred to Aristotle. Aristotle understood by productive work, poesis, primarily poetics and agriculture. He shared the general Athenian contempt for manufacture and technology. For this reason, he was unable to see that agriculture is rooted in a kind of technology. In contrast to Aristotle, whose inquiry centered on biology, the Ionian philosophers, from Thales to Democritus, investigated the generation of the universe, the emergence of life, the evolution of life forms, and the historical development of human societies in non-teleological ways. Aristotle practically makes fun of Empedocles for conceiving of evolution of natural kinds haphazardly without purposes and perfections. It is the influence of Ionian natural philosophy, the pre-Socratics as a whole, rather than Aristotle, that we find in this passage from Diodorus of Sicily in the first century CE, a passage that would again become central to the European Enlightenment when Jean-Jacques Rousseau wrote his first and second discourses on the origin of language and of social inequality. What is emphasized in human biological and cultural evolution is precisely contingency and adaptive purpose. But since groups of this kind arose over every part of the inhabited world, not all men had the same language, inasmuch as every group organized the elements of its speech by mere chance. This is the explanation of the present existence of every conceivable kind of language, and furthermore, of these first groups to be formed came all the original nations of the world. Rather than thinking the diversity of languages as a curse or fall from the Tower of Babel, the Aeonian tradition, like modern linguistics, emphasizes the arbitrariness of the sign and phoneme. And in this way, we owe as well the birth of semiotics to Aeonian natural thought. In conclusion, for our unit on the pre-Socratics, the last thing that Karatani addresses is why Aeonian thought became suppressed. Despite the difference of viewpoint, this did not happen during the time of Plato and Aristotle by their hands or subsequently. It only occurred when Christian philosophy utilized Plato and Aristotle to this effect, the result being that the kind of evolutionary theory presented by the Aeonians did not return even with the development of modern physics in the West. The spell of Aristotelian natural philosophy was not to be fundamentally rejected until Darwin's The Origin of Species. Darwin did not arrive at this kind of thinking through philosophical speculation, but his epoch-making significance was to place contingency at the basis of being and to reject teleology of any kind. In doing so, whether aware or not, Darwin recuperated Aeonian thought, which had long been suppressed by Aristotelian thinking. For the most part, modern physics inherits still the Aristotelian metaphysics or theology, repurposed as classical mechanics or relativity theory. However, quantum mechanics decisively displaces this perspective. It recuperates the Aeonian position that matter and motion are inseparable. That is to say, the quantum light, or the electron, is at the same time both particle, matter, and wave motion, returns to Aeonian principles. I suppose we've seen that the last great school of Aeonian natural thought, that of atomism, is what justifies, perhaps only retrospectively, the image of the early Greek philosophers as the dawn of Western science. The closest thing we come to the secular, atheistic, purely scientific view of the world we study the pre-Socratics is Xenophanes' anti-mythical emphasis on the otherness of God, or perhaps the emphasis of the atomists on the material genesis of all that is divine. I hope you've enjoyed your overall unit on the pre-Socratics, and I look forward to next week when we will begin our fundamental study of Socrates. Have a good week.